Welcome back. AC lesson number three. Before we go on, there's a few more things about sweet spot number one and sweet spot number two. More information about using them, testing the refrigeration system. Remember sweet spot number one? That can be the hard one. That's the suction manifold on the compressor. Okay, sorry, right here. Sweet spot number two is usually easier to get to. It's at the firewall. I know they sort of seem the same, but this is a bigger test. They're both important tests. Understanding the clutch operation. If the engine is running, I hope you can see this little arrow. If the engine is running, the pulley is rotating. The pulley is rotating. When the AC compressor is engaged, the clutch should be spinning. If the clutch is spinning, that means the refrigeration system is trying to work. Let's go on some more. As soon as the clutch engages, almost instantly at sweet spot number two, under a normal system, notice the amount of eyes. It takes half a second for sweet spot number one to start to feel cold almost instantly on a normal system. It takes a few seconds on a normal system for it to work its way all the way to the end of the suction, but they're both important. Here I'm trying to represent non-functioning or partially functioning refrigeration system. One of the ingredients in the ice glass is missing. Either it doesn't have enough Freon, the compressor is not working correctly, the condenser is not getting cooled off, or there's a problem with the circulation. Okay, let's go on. If it takes 30 seconds or a minute, if it takes a little while, then more than just 1 second, this sweet spot number two should get cold instantly. In this particular situation, something is wrong and it's going to take half a minute or a whole minute. If it takes a little while, that means that it's not working correctly. On the left, this is what the evaporator should feel like, look like, and this is what you should imagine it. On the right, this is a half a glass of ice water representing that something is wrong with the refrigeration system. When the four ingredients of the refrigeration system come together, we have a full glass of evaporator ice. Okay. A good working refrigeration system has to have the right amount of refrigerant. It's very common for them to go low. And we'll talk about overcharging. Oh, more is not better. All the cylinders in the compressor need to be hitting correctly. Not just some of them, all of them. We have to have good heat removal from the condenser or it's not going to fill that glass of ice water. These are all the ingredients. They're all just as important. They're all going to create a problem. You will see examples of circulation problems. It is so common for the system to go undercharged. That means it's not enough refrigerant because it leaked out. Compressors leak, evaporators leak, condensers leak, fittings leak. Everything leaks. It's very common for the system to go down on refrigerant. It's not unusual for the compressors to fail. If the compressor, where's my compressor? There's a compressor. If the compressor is damaged, I don't care how much Freon you put in there just right, it's not going to fill your glass of ice water up. Okay? If we're having problem removing heat from the condenser, either because the condenser is dirty, excessive stop and go driving, inoperative cooling fans, a slipping fan clutch, all added together with extreme severe heat, we're going to have problems filling that glass of ice water. If that glass of ice water is not full, it's not just because it needs Freon. One of the four ingredients is off a little bit. Let's talk about circulation problems. On the top is a new orifice tube. You'll see more about the orifice tube. On the bottom, you see a dirty orifice tube. You see these little fibers and that stuff in there? That's the Teflon rings from the AC compressor. The compressor has just puked its guts and they wind up here at the tube. The tube will need to be replaced. And when you pull the tube out, it's obvious the compressor has been trashed. Here is another filthy tube with the Teflon material all over it. We have to have the correct amount of Freon. We have to have good compressor. We have to have good cooling or removing the heat of the condenser, and we have to have good circulation. All these are the ingredients. Do you want a full glass of ice water or do you want half a glass of ice water? Again, four things have to happen in order for this ice water to be full. And it's not just the responsibility of the refrigerant. This is the compressor, the condenser, and the circulation. If any of those four ingredients are off, your evaporator is not going to be cold.
Sweet spot number two should instantly get cold when the glass of ice water is full. Oh, about 3 seconds later, it should also be nice and cold. Time for a new subject, the magic of the Freon, the refrigerant. There's two magics that are happening here. Well, let me fix it. You'll learn that the can has to be in a certain position. It's called a liquid position in order for it to do its thing. Two magics, super cold, super fast. Okay. The refrigerant is a special chemical that is designed to create cold, and it does an excellent job. Super cold, super fast. On the right, I still have that can representing the refrigerant being sprayed out. Over here on the left, I have two expansion valves. This is an expansion valve, and this is an expansion valve. And this is called an expansion tube or expansion valve. They're all doing the same thing. As the refrigerant passes through these devices, whether it's the block valve, the 90-degree valve, or the expansion tube, there is a change of pressure, change of temperature. It's just like the magic that comes out of the can. It's cold, just like it, just coming out of the can. Here is our two styles of expansion valves. This is the block style. This is the original style. They're still underneath the hood. This one, expansion tube, orifice tube. The tube itself is that part of that brass tubing or straw on the inside. The rest of this is just the screen for filtering purposes. Expansion tube, orifice tube. This is where the magic happens. Yes, technically it's minus 80 degrees below zero. That's super cold, super fast. This is where the magic happens. As a refrigerant passes through the tube or the valve, it changes pressure, changes temperature. It gets cold. Why should you know where the tube is located? Because it's going to get dirty. You see those metal shavings? That's the guts of the compressor. No, that's not Teflon this time. This is aluminum. Okay. On the left, we have the new clean one. On the right, that looks like shavings from the compressor. And you're also going to learn that once in a while, there's this mud device. It's called desiccant that comes out of your drying element that winds up plugging up and causes circulation problems. So where is this tube located? Three answers. Three possible locations for the expansion tube. At the end of the liquid line, in the middle of the liquid line, at the beginning of the liquid line, somewhere on the liquid line. So we should know the liquid line. You should already know the suction hose. That's the larger. The opposite of the largest one is the thinnest one, the smallest one. This is called the liquid line. A good place to find the liquid line is going to be next to the suction. Over here at the firewall, this is the liquid line, okay? Here's an example of how the orifice tube can be located in the middle of the liquid line. Here, in this case, is located at the end of the liquid line. These little dimples or crimps are indicators that that's where the tube is located. That's how you're going to start looking for this. It's a very, very subtle hint, but it's there. Sometimes those little dimples are covered up with a little foam. You're going to have to peel back and see what's going on. Here you can start to see the beginning of the tube. This is a serviceable one. Sometimes the tubes are non-serviceable. That means you have to replace the whole line. Okay. I'm sorry, I have to go fast because YouTube limits me to under 15 minutes or else it's a hassle. See those little dimples right there? That's where the tube is. Over here at the fitting, that's where you would take it apart and yank the tube out. It's very important that you know where the tube is. And in this case, here's an example of the tube is located near the condenser, which is at the beginning of the liquid line. This is the beginning of the liquid line. Those little dimples right there indicate that that's where it's located. So there's three places for the tube to be located: at the end, in the middle, or at the beginning of the liquid line. Just depends on the vehicle that you're working with. Here, looks like we're still in the front of the vehicle. That's the condenser. This is the beginning of the liquid line. The expansion tube can be located there. New subject. Let me identify the two types of refrigeration systems used on most vehicles. I'm going to call it the tube type and the valve type. Okay. On the top, I have two examples of the average looking expansion valves. We have the original style, a 90 degree type. And then we have the block type. These are both expansion valves. On the bottom is the expansion tube. Let me give you a little bit about that one. Well, but here they are, side by side, the two refrigeration system. On the left, we have a compressor, condenser, we have evaporator. We should know some of these names. Over here on the right, we have the same thing. They almost look the same, but let's zoom in just a little bit. On this particular one, there it is. There's the compressor. This is our suction. This is the cold one. This is coming in. This is called the discharge hose. Let's go ahead and identify all our three lines, okay? You already know about the suction. This is the suction side. You're learning about the liquid. This is the liquid line, and right here is the discharge hose. There's only three hoses, three lines. We have suction, discharge, and liquid. In this particular liquid line, at the end of the liquid line is the orifice tube. Understand that that tube can be located at the end and in the middle and way over here in the beginning. This is a possible location tube. Over here on this particular one, it's very close to the same. We still have the suction, compressor, discharge, condenser. We still have a liquid line, but in this case, we have an expansion valve, and that's what the next lessons are going to be, the variations on the locations of the expansion valves. The expansion valves represents that. There, that's the end. Click on the draw. End.